So we'll look at the notion of normal forms. We're not going to look at the normalization theory per se. That is covered in the fifth chapter of Prasadarshan's book, and you can read that up. What I will try and do is I'll try to give you the basic concepts of functional dependencies and how exactly you can, even if you start with some arbitrary collection of data in tables, how you can examine the schema of those tables and get the right design in a normalized form. That's what we shall look at. Then we'll move over to a different topic where we'll discuss the modern multi-tier applications. Currently, what you have been doing in the labs are from a front-end PC, you are connecting to a back-end database. So traditionally, you call it a two-tier architecture. But the better architecture is a three-tier architecture, and in general, the multi-tier architecture, what are the issues there? More specifically, we'll look at the problems of necessity of integrating multiple applications, not just within the organization, but across organizations. This has given rise to a more recent standard, which is still emerging, but a lot of it is already well established, called service-oriented architecture. We shall see what exactly service-oriented architecture is, because our endeavor is that the new applications that we'll develop should generally comply with the SOA. And finally, we'll look at the performance modeling, where the issues of performance, what are the basic issues? We'll look at some little theory there. Actually, the theory contains a law called Little's Law. So we shall look at that. We shall look at some notion of benchmarking. Much of that material comes courtesy Dr. Rajesh Mansharamani of Tata Consultancy Services. We are using those slides. He has agreed to release those slides in the open source. Okay. So we'll, to begin with, in this session, we'll look at software design. The specific topics that we look at are a very brief and quick review of system analysis. We had discussed the ER model in the first session. We had not discussed the data flow diagrams. That's the other component of analysis. The only important point that we take for today's discussion from the data flow diagrams is the notion of stores, but it's useful to look at the notion of data flow diagrams in general, and we'll then concentrate on table design, where we'll introduce the notion of normalization. This is the review of an SRS document. I think in the first session I had given you a glimpse of the document. The document would generally have an introduction, it will have functional specifications, it will then have data models and associated data dictionary. The data models could, for example, be ER model, or it could be an object model. It would have a data flow model. The ER model captures the static characteristics of data and the interrelation. The data flow model defines the dynamics of how the data moves across the organization and how it is transformed in the process. Additionally, there are user interface requirements. There are requirements of interfaces to other systems. There are procedures and workflows which need to be explicitly identified. For the entire software, an acceptance criteria must be defined right at the time of system requirement specification, so that if you hand over that activity to someone else, whether it is an internal group or outside group, that group knows exactly how the software will be accepted after it is developed. We generally don't do these kind of things internally, but I would suggest that this should be done. For example, there should be a user acceptance test which should be done by a group other than the software development group. It's very important to keep that partition. We had looked at ER model, but let's look at the flow model, how the data flows. So as information moves through the system, it gets transformed. We'll again go back to the example that I had cited of the course registration. At the time of registration, each one of you would fill up a form, and that form is the entry point of information. But as the information comes in, and if you have designed the internal storage tables using entity model, for example, you would transform that data. So you will not keep the form as it is, or even if you keep it, will be a transient storage. You will essentially transform that, and the persistent storage that you will have will be your tables in the data. However, when the information moves further, for example, an analysis of the performance of one individual student, where you calculate the cumulative performance index at the end of all grading, then that report has to be submitted to the student in a form different than what appears inside your database. Because in that output, which will be a grade report, you must print the student's name, the roll number, the other antecedents, not only the subject code, but also the name of the subject, the grade obtained, the total cumulative performance, etc. None of this information is available in a single table in your database. So there will be another transformation. The point is, as the data moves, the data comes in, gets transformed, gets stored, gets processed, gets further transformed, may get further stored, and ultimately goes out to the users. Modeling this flow is an important part of the system analysis. A transformation of any kind represents a system function. So basically, system function means there is some application logic that gets applied. How do you extract this information? What do you multiply this with? How do you add this and that? That is the specification of your application logic or algorithm. So correspondingly, any transformation which describes a system function will ultimately get implemented as a program module. We now distinguish between data and program module. Identification of program modules and what specifications for the functionality that program module would have is the job of the analysis of the data flow. Such flow and attendant transformation is captured. There are multiple models again. The data flow modeling or data flow diagram modeling is one of the ways. The data flow diagrams is a diagrammatic tool and therefore easy to understand for at least simple and a simple application which can be comprehensively read. As the application becomes more complex, the data flow nitty-gritties will be many more. Consequently, the data flow model or the data flow diagrams themselves are organized in a hierarchical model, as we shall see. Here is an example of a data flow. Consider participants for a continuing education program like this. Now, here the participant will fill up a registration form. It could be any student comparable to the old example that we gave. Let's take the example, let's consider this to be an example of the actual students interacting with an institution. The first thing that the validation process should do is to check whether the student has paid the fees for the semester. Otherwise, you cannot permit that student to register. Notice that the registration information is quite independent of the payment of fees. The payment of fees could have been done quite independently as a different operation. But if it is not done, you got to cross-check. Please note that this is actually a control specification. You remember we said the data specification, the processing specification, and the control specification. Now this is a control specification. Unless this is done, don't do this. This needs to be captured somewhere in your analysis. What you see here are called data stores. So there is supposedly an account master, there is an enrollment master. I am using a terminology which is familiar to the COBOL programming terminology, but these could very well be database tables. As a matter of fact, whichever name you give while identifying such stores, ultimately you will transfer these in some appropriate form into the database tables. You will notice that this arrow indicates that what flows here is a registration form. What flows here is an error list in case the processing says invalid registration. Of course, this would go to another process which I have just temporarily called pnext. There will be another processing logic there. It could involve printing of that list, giving it to some clerk, something, something. You will recall that we need to transform the data to give a roll list to a faculty member. So that will be another output that will come up. You will notice that each of these arrows have a label marking these arrows. These two arrows, however, do not have labels. Although we can interpret from the context what is the information that is flowing. For example, here I might be sending the roll number to the account master and I might be getting just yes or no answer. Here I might be storing all the registration information. But nothing can be left to interpretation in a formal tool. Therefore, it is necessary to have such headings associated or labels associated with each arrow, as a matter of fact with each symbol. This is a very important thing. Whichever modeling tool that you use in life, if there is any diagram, there cannot be any component of a diagram which does not have a label, and there cannot be a complete report unless that particular label is expanded in full detail somewhere. A lacuna left at this stage could cause tremendous problems later in the development. Here are the basic DFD symbols. These symbols, for example, an external entity, let's say a donor to an institution, okay, is an external entity. Data flow, an account statement. The nomenclature used inside here actually denotes a sort of system analysis for capturing pledges by alumni and the actual donations given and so on. So there will be a donor as an entity. There will be an account statement which may represent a data flow going out of the system to the original donor. There could be a process which could say check expense, whether the expenses under a particular project for which donations have been received are within the limits, or how are they been done, or they are required to be cross-checked, validated. So all the programming logic will come there. Pledge info is a store. A pledge means commitment to give some donation in future. So what kind of things you will keep there? You will keep probably the donor's name, some address or something, the amount pledged, the modus operandi of the pledge, meaning whether he says I will give all of this money next month, or I will give over next 3 years, one third, one third, one third. Please note that this does not amount therefore directly to a table in your database. This only amounts to capturing of what information you need to store, because this, what you are doing this is at the time of analysis. Okay, there are many times when we get confused and anticipate a table in our final application and therefore try to see whatever we put as our store in analysis to be a table. That is incorrect. During analysis, you are just supposed to capture the actual information needs of the organization. So for example, if you have no computerized system, you will go through the registers and files and other things that you have, and you will just notice how things are currently captured. And that's the way you will sort of indicate that storage. It is this, and in fact such storage, which is of relevance to our discussion today. So an external entity is a source of or consumer of information, obvious. Arrow represents flow of data. Process describes transformation. Although we are not going to discuss this any further, but subsequently when you design and develop applications, it is this process specification which will get converted into some kind of application logic. So this represents the algorithm, which gets data or puts data from or to arrows, and it contains processing specification, or PSPEC it is called, processing specification. Last but not the least is the store, which stores the data. I will restate that the store as depicted in this model has nothing to do directly with our tables in the design. Incidentally, some stores may get automatically mapped as tables, but that is not the idea here. Stores means just what information is stored in what form. What is important here is to have an associated data dictionary. This data dictionary is an extremely important concept. Without a data dictionary, any diagrammatic model is completely useless for real world. Diagrammatic model is good. The diagram is good for conveying in a nutshell the basic scope of things to a human reader. But the details which are required for subsequent program development will come from a data dictionary. So each symbol must have an associated label, rule number one. It is surprising that even in the professional organizations, particularly smaller ones, sometimes the data flow diagrams which are submitted do not have, I have seen that myself, and I have asked people to redo the work. The reason that happens is that the person who draws that diagram knows every arrow by heart and therefore assumes things. So as usual, anything that is written by one individual or a group must be validated by somebody else. Okay, so this is called, when you do that for actual program code, you call it structured walkthrough. For other documents, you call it a review. The review must be done by somebody other than. Data dictionary entries must define that particular label in terms of its metadata. So whatever is the metadata, that should be defined. the process narrative must accompany every process blob that you put there. So it's not sufficient to say validate. Exactly what are the logic for validation is to be done. This happens in many existing institutions where the internal process documentation is not strong. So we have seen, for example, that the first time computerization in many organizations actually resulted in some documentation of the process that was followed, the rules that were followed. Unfortunately, these were not documented in English because that time the software engineering was not well understood. So people simply wrote programs. You would know how many of LIC's operational functional rules are actually available only in the form of COBOL logic and not in the form of an English document. This is bad, but there is nobody to blame because there was no such system. Ideally, a software requirement specification document will contain complete description of the processing logic required, because that is what would be implemented. So for people like us, the task would now be to construct the reverse documentation. And if we don't do it during the migration, it will never get done. So when we migrate, we might retain the COBOL code for application logic, but it is important to reverse construct this kind of processing specification. So here is an example entry registration form which may contain roll number, name, course, audit, credit, timetable, slot. Again, just like you describe the attributes in greater details, here also these are not attributes, they are pieces of information, this is metadata. But you must describe to the same extent of depth, because that is what would then ultimately result in the correct description of your final model or database design. Validation information, what is the input to store is roll number, return from store is name, CPI, fees payment status, whatever one. There is usually a context diagram which is called the level 0 DFD. Remember I mentioned that DFDs could be in multiple hierarchical levels. And that is because when a system is complex, it is not possible to have a single data flow diagram depicting everything. Such a diagram will span the whole wall. So you have A4 size pages. So you first start with a hierarchically topmost level, which is called the level 0 DFD, and this is also called the fundamental system model. There is a single bubble with incoming and outgoing arrows mainly showing the external entities involved. So hardly any processing logic here. It's a system diagram. The functional partitioning of this diagram then, okay, will be done to derive several level 1 DFDs. And each one of the level 1 DFD will go into level 2 DFDs and so on. Here is a context diagram example for what we call our Center for Distance Engineering Education program. Okay. As I said, we conduct these programs and beam those courses live through satellite to various centers. So we have remote centers. We need information about those remote centers, where it is located, how many students could be there, what courses are offered at that place, what labs they have, whatever. Who are the participants on any course? So the basic information about participants. Which are the courses offered by our center? So the information about all courses, when they are offered, etc. Any prerequisite for that course, what? Who are the faculty members who are associated with teaching of these courses? There could be faculty members who are simply registered with CD, but they have not yet offered a course. So this could be an independent info.
Sir, while drawing DFDs, I want to know what should be the level of abstraction?
The level of abstraction ultimately, the numbers don't matter. Ultimately, you should be able to design your software without asking any question to any human being. Now you can understand the design. So if some figures are to be rounded off for calculation of some accounting, that must be stated in the specification somewhere. It is a good question, because these level of details are often not captured. And this particularly this thing is seen in in-house teams, because in-house teams have a natural expertise on the domain. So a whole lot of things which are assumed, they are just in the minds of people. in a professional setting is not permitted. So the level of detail is this. I mean, always apply the thumb rule, given the details which you are doing analysis, now put a programmer's hat or a designer's hat. Can I program everything without talking to anyone from the information that I have written here? The answer is no, more information is required. A typical SRS document, by the way, it is not uncommon that for even a simple system, it would be about 1,000-page document. For a complex system, it is not uncommon to have 6 or 7 volumes, each of 1,000 pages. I mean, there's no shortcut to it. By the way, in software development, more English has to be written than programs. English or Telugu, Tamil, whatever, doesn't matter, but that is required. So, good point here. But what this shows is merely a context diagram. It's just the beginning model. Then you will refine, expand this to level 1 DFD, add more detailed processes. Flow continuity is necessary. If you take any level 1 DFD and you show 2 inputs from here and 1 output from here, any further refinement must contain only a subset of these inputs. A refinement cannot now suddenly go back and get some more. Additional inputs and outputs may, additional flows may emerge within that. So that continuity needs to be maintained. So expansion must have the same IO. Anyway, we digress, we go back to our normalization thing quickly. But I thought, since I am describing the nature of analysis, for the sake of completeness, let me also mention that apart from processing specs and the data flow and the application functionality, and along with the entity model which captures the static piece of relationship between data and data description, you also need to describe user interfaces. So modeling interactive screens, for example, which will capture and validate input, which will do query response retrieval. Modeling reports, what should be the contents, what should be the format, on screen, on printer. Again, as COBOL programmers, you would know that a very large and significant time of yours is spent in writing reports or writing queries. So functionality-wise, the more important functionality might be the complicated application logic for processing transactions. But the amount of time that one has to spend is far more in reports and queries. Then there could be some special interfaces, like a PDA interface or like a hardware-software interface. You know, a truck goes onto the weigh bridge and automatically the weight is taken. So there is some hardware, there is a spring-loaded weigh bridge, and the information comes out, not just in terms of a pointer which you can read, but also is digitally captured and automatically transmitted. So these could be special interfaces. Screen and forms layout need to be very carefully done. Source and target stores must be defined. At this stage, you will define the target store or the source store from the context of analysis. Ultimately, these stores will get mapped into multiple tables, or multiple stores may get mapped into a single table. And you need to carry on this connection between the forms and reports to the store, to the ultimate tables, because that is where the data will have to come from. There are operational considerations. That is what we call user friendliness. People wrongly define operating system to be user-friendly or not user-friendly. That is biggest nonsense. Operating system should be programmer-friendly. An end user should never see an operating system. An end user should see a screen of your application. And then it doesn't matter what operating system one is using. Keystroke minimization is an important criteria. Number of keys that the end user has to press should be minimized. The information system design then consists of, so this is the analysis part. The design part will consist of data design, it will consist of software architecture design, it will consist of interface design. You will define a user manual at this stage. When do you write user manual for your programs? Typically after you have written the program. Not accepted. Absolutely not accepted. In fact, unless there exists a user manual, a single line of code cannot be written. So you have to do a lot of unlearning for professional practice. The reason is very simple. The reason is, I want to implement what I perceive the user requires, not the other way around. What I have implemented is what the user will get. They're fundamental different dichotomy. So interface design and user manual, design of transactions and workflow, and design of tests. There are two levels at which these tests are designed, by the way, for the software. One is the designer themselves design tests. So these tests are executed by internal developers. There's a completely different kind of tests which are designed by end users or on behalf of end users for accepting your software. That activity must not be done by the development group. That activity must be done by what we call the UAT group or user acceptance testing group. Okay. We now come to the design of data, which is the purpose of this discussion today. Mapping stores into SQL tables, that is what we wish to do. First of all, design should avoid having redundant information for obvious reason. If you have redundant information, then anytime information changes, if that is redundant, you have to change it at two places, three places, four places. Secondly, the schema must permit relevant information of our application to be represented properly. This seems to be an oxymoron. Isn't that natural? Isn't that normal? Why am I stating it? While designing the table, if I am not careful, it might so happen that I am not able to properly represent my organizational information. We shall see an example. The purpose of the normalization theory, in fact, is to ensure that by its application, you solve both these problems. You ensure that the design avoids storage redundancy, and you ensure that all relevant information is properly represented. To illustrate that there could be something wrong, we take a view that, suppose we take all the organization-wide information and store it in a single table. Theoretically, it is possible. One file contains everything, or one table contains everything. That it is not good is what we need to ascertain, and then decide what should be good. That is where we use the normalization theory. So while we discuss this normalization theory today, let me also point out that you might need design of additional tables. These could be transient tables. These could be transaction storing tables. These could be tables storing bulk files which come from someplace or which need to be sent out. The conventional file system is not dead. It will never be dead. The conventional files need to be used at least at the interface of your database, any external interface. So how do you design those files for bulk input-output? How do you design tables for logs? How do you design tables for audit trails? These are all important issues. These are typically not covered in the domain data description part. The domain data description part will relate to tables which capture the domain-related information. But this is workflow-related information or process-related information, and that needs to be identified during analysis. There are many normal forms. You can read the book to study more, fourth normal form, fifth normal form, or whatever. The first normal form of it, the normal form, by the way, is the property of a table. A table is in one of the normal forms. Whether you like it or not, a table will always have an associated normal form with it. The characteristic of the normal form, the table defines which normal form it is. So it's important to look at the definition of normal forms. The first normal form requires that all attributes should have atomic values. That means single values. Multi-valued attributes are ruled out. So if you have single valued attributes, so this is clear, first normal form. Obviously then, since we have already discussed and ruled out use of multi-valued attributes, almost any table that we design will be necessarily in first normal form. It is necessary, but not a very vital requirement, as we shall see. Vital requirements come later. The second normal form. The second normal form definition states, all non-key attributes of a table should be fully functionally dependent on the primary key. What is functional dependency? What is full functional dependency? And why should non-key attributes of a table should be fully functionally dependent on the primary key? These are the questions that we need to answer. There is a third normal form which extends the requirement of non-key attributes to be fully functionally dependent on the primary key non-transitively. We shall see what non-transitive is, and you will be able to do that non-transitive dependence check to get it in the third normal form. There is a Boyce-Codd normal form, or the Boyce-Codd normal form requires the non-key attributes to be fully functionally dependent not only on primary keys but candidate keys as well. We are not going to discuss the Boyce-Codd normal form, BCNF as it is called, or the fifth and fourth and fifth and sixth normal forms, etc. In general, if you get your tables, all your tables in a schema in the third normal form, more or less you can guarantee that it's a good design. So you need not go beyond third normal form ordinarily. We'll now define functional dependencies using the notion that we put all our data in a single table. Do you recognize this table? Do you recall the join operation that we had discussed? So this is what would have come out of that join table approximate. Since we saw that we are required to do a join in order to get meaningful information, why not say that whatever is that table is the table in which I store the data? Look at the convenience. Whatever way you want, you can search by putting a index on any one of these things and you can get all the information. So what is wrong in keeping my information in such a form? Let's look at the way information is maintained here. It has roll number, name, hostel, room number, cumulative performance index or CPI, then course code, course grade, course name, course credit. Practically all the information that we had seen required. So what is wrong in this? We notice a few things. Do you notice redundancy here? Name, for example, if Sunita is registered for 6 courses, her name will appear 6 times.
Course name.
The course name again is repeated. Course code is repeated. I mean, course code, of course, we'll have to repeat in the registration thing, but course name is getting repeated, credits are being repeated. If there is a large information like address, etc., will get repeated n number of times. What is wrong with that? This space, first of all. But suppose I say disk is so cheap that I can go to Lamington Road and buy. But there are processing problems. For example, before we go further, we define. So we shall see what are the problems with the redundancy. There are other problems which we can't see clearly. We shall see that when we connect the notion of functional dependency to some of the observations of operations on this table. So first let us look at the notion of functional dependence. These are all attributes. What is the key attribute for this table? S-roll and C-code. So S-roll plus C-code is the primary key. These are individual attributes. First of all, the functional dependency is defined in terms of an attribute being functionally dependent on another attribute. When you say A arrow B, it means B is functionally dependent on A, or alternately A determines B. What it means is that whenever a value in your table, any value appears for A and certain value appears for B, then what is guaranteed is whenever the same value for A appears again, the same value for B will appear. No other value can appear at all. So they are essentially related. They are dependent on each other. That is the definition. For example, let's go back to the previous slide. Wherever roll number 5012 appears, the name Sunita appears. It does not matter how many times 5012 is repeated, the name will only be Sunita. There could be another Sunita with some other roll number. So the roll number is not dependent on name. But whenever this roll number occurs, the name will always be Sunita. Therefore, Sunita is dependent on this roll number, the name Sunita. So name is dependent functionally on roll. Same thing you can say about the course name. Same thing you can say about the credits. For example, there could be many courses with 8 credits. But what is guaranteed is whenever CS413 happens, the credits will be saved. So credit is dependent on coarse code. If the names are unique, the credit could also be dependent on coarse name. In that case, coarse name would become something like a candidate key. It is not a candidate key here, because here the primary key is of course this plus.
Sir, here the primary key is Astrol plus C code.
Yes.
And now you are telling that functional dependency, that value of B should depend on A. So if A is a combination of attribute,
then it should depend on the combination. Functional dependency talks about dependency of one attribute on any other attribute or a set of attributes. The primary key relation is not yet brought into picture. What we have defined is just the notion of functional key, functional dependency.
In that second normal form, it is...
No. We are not talking about normal forms. We are talking about the definition of functional dependency. Functional dependency can be defined between any two attributes or between any two groups of attributes. So what we are doing is we are just understanding what a functional this thing is. We will connect it up with the normal form in a short. It is possible, for example, that something could be functionally dependent on a group of attributes. Okay. For example, this name, S name, is fully functionally dependent on S role. Is also fully functionally dependent on S role plus C code. The statement is incorrect in so far as I am using the word fully. S name is functionally dependent on S role, correct. S name is functionally dependent on S role and C code, correct. But S name is fully functionally dependent only on S role and C code. It is not fully functionally dependent on S role. Or it should be the other way around. Yes.
It is fully functionally dependent on S role.
So if I have now, what is emerging out of this discussion is, if I have a combination of attributes, and if there is a certain attribute which depends upon this combination, whether it fully depends or not is determined by looking at the individual components of this combination. And if this fellow is dependent, functionally dependent on any subset of this combination, then it is not fully functionally dependent on the original one, because it is dependent only on the subset. So this is the distinction between full functional dependency and mere functional dependence. We capture it here. For example, SH, SR, SCPI are dependent on S role, that is obvious. C name and C credit are dependent on C code. Grade is dependent on the composite key S role, C code. Notice that grade is not functionally dependent on either S role, nor it is functionally dependent on C code. So we say grade is fully functionally dependent on S role plus C code, because it is not dependent on any part alone. However, SCPI or C name is not fully functionally dependent on this combination, because it depends on one of the two as well. This is the crux of the full functional dependence. Now you will realize, as we discuss further, why full functional dependency on primary key is necessary. We shall see that in a moment. Because in the previous table, let's go back to the previous slide, two previous slides. So this is the table in which we have all the information kept. The primary key of this table is S role plus C code. So barring these two fields, these two attributes, each one of the other attributes is a non-key attribute. Now we come to the normal definition form. In the first normal form, there is no dependency notion. In the second normal form, we say that every non-key attribute should be fully functionally dependent on the primary key. In this particular table, we see that it is not so. Every non-key attribute, in fact, the only non-key attribute which is fully functionally dependent on primary key is
grade.
Grade is the only fellow which is fully functionally dependent. This one. But SH, SR, SName, SCPI, they are fully functionally dependent only on S row. If a attribute is dependent on any other attribute, there is any other single attribute, there is always fully functionally dependent. Similarly, credit, C name, etc. are dependent only on C code. So they are not fully functionally dependent on primary key. What it means is that this table is not in the second normal form. What is the impact of this table not being in second normal form is what we shall see. We had already mentioned, let's go to the next slide now. All non-key attributes should be fully functionally dependent on the primary key. Many non-key attributes in our table are not fully functionally dependent. Therefore, the table is not in second normal form. What we want to know is, what is the problem if this criteria is not satisfied? So, can you guess what could be the problems? We already talked about redundancy. So, redundant data storage is a problem. But is storage only the problem? Because that I can say that disk is not very costly, so let it be there. The real problem is in processing. Any time a redundant value is updated, I will have to update it at multiple places. So if Sunita changes her name, then it will have to be updated at many places. She changes her hostel room, it will have to be updated at many places. If a course credits change, course name changes, any one of those. Anywhere, wherever there is redundancy. So if Sunita changes her hostel, Hostel 10 will have to be changed, updated at multiple places. If the name of the course CS634 from Info System is changed to something else, since a course may be registered by 300 students, I will have to update 300 records in my file or in my table. That means ghodagiri work. If this was the only reason, then I would say yes, it is important. But it does not seem to harm me really. After all, by mistake, if while I do the table design, if table is not in second normal form, I may end up doing some more ghodagi. But it is not critical for my business. My business should run. Is that the case? Is there any other possible problem with this design? This brings us to the avoidance of redundancy is of course a critical requirement. But it is not the more critical requirement. So what could be the critical? What could happen if I use this thing other than redundancy related? So let us look at, after all, something will happen to the information in the table only when we add, update or delete. Consider a deletion. If Muthukrishnan, who is registered for a single course HS412, and he drops the course. He is registered for only one course, but let's say if he has some serious family problem, he goes to the director of the institute, says, this semester, okay, I want leave. I have to take care of my family. He is given, of course, he said. So he goes back and he is supposed to come back next semester. What will happen when he drops this course? This record will be deleted. When I delete this record, information about Muthukrishnan also is lost permanently because there is no other table. Is that acceptable? No. Can I still maintain Muthukrishnan's information without the course registration? Answer unfortunately is no, because course code and so roll number together are a primary key. If he deregisters, at most you might think of putting a null value here for the course. If you do that, it becomes an invalid primary key. That record cannot be kept in this table. So this record will have to be deleted. Now you will recall that I had mentioned that an important requirement of the design is all the pertinent information for the organization must be properly represented. So if I am your customer, even if my policy has matured, you might delete me from the policy information. Should you delete me from your customer information? Today you don't maintain customer information. You have no information about people who don't have policies. Think of the perspective of marketing. How many potential customers you have in India? 100 crore. You have no information about them. Even when you have information about someone like me who has a policy, The day my policy matures, that information goes. Am I not a prospective client to you? Just as is he not a valid student of the organization? When next semester comes back, he comes back, would it be all right to ask him, who are you? And then say, he will say, my roll number is 89004039. He says, no, I have no record. You don't exist. So it is not possible for the organization to store the fundamentally important information properly in such a design. Is it related to the normal form? We can see, yes, it is. If we notice why this is happening, is because all the information related to Muthukrishnan comes from all those non-key attributes, his name, hostel number, etc., etc., which was not functionally fully dependent on the total primary key. It was dependent only on the roll number. So when this record got deleted, he entirely got deleted. So perhaps if our table was in second normal form, this would not have happened. Let's see whether this is true or not. Since we are now, it is obvious to us that this table is not in the second normal form, we must decompose this table. Normalization theory, by the way, is not merely for theoretical analysis. It also provides a way of design. If a table is not in normal form, you can decompose this table into multiple tables such that each one of the resulting table is in normal form. How do we decompose? Let's say we don't know about Muthu or the semantics of the information, but we only know the functional dependence. What are the functional dependencies here? The name, hostel, room number and CPI are all functionally dependent on one part of the key, S row. Course name and course credits are dependent on another part of the key, C code. And grade is dependent fully functionally on the composite. Now we say that we will separate out things. Separation out is not taking it out. Separation in case of design consists of projecting the table. You know the project operation. So I do a project operation on this table. And I project only those columns which contain attributes which are fully functionally dependent on a part of the key, along with that key. That becomes one table. I do the same thing with another part of the key. Then all the attributes which are fully functionally dependent on the primary key, I project them into a third table. Now you can see that each one of the resulting table is fully in second normal form. Project S role and attributes dependent on it, make one table. It will become a table with primary key as S role. Project course code and attributes dependent on it, the primary key will be course code. And project S role and C code and the dependent attribute grade, the primary key will be S role and C code. This decomposition, you will recall, was actually the table design that you would have got had you followed the ER model. You are an entity student, entity course, and entity registered for. And these were exactly the tables that came out of mapping those entities into table design. But that is incidental. In fact, we only note that if we have used ER model as a starting point, we are likely to get tables which are in second normal form if we map those entities or the association sets, relationship sets into table style. A lossless decomposition must be ensured, which means we must get back original information through joins. So if I have no ER model and I am following this, what it means is that if I have these three tables, and projection means I have projected the data from that original table into these three tables. Now, if I join these three tables together appropriately, I must be able to get the original table. That is called a lossless join. Many of you may feel that this is obvious. So here, the lossless join does not really mean dropping of data from tables. If the decomposition is not lossless and you have these multiple tables which you have decomposed the original one into and you do a join, Sometimes you get extra information which is not there in the original table, if the decomposition is not properly done. That extra information is also called a lossy design. Please note that loss of information does not necessarily mean dropping of some information. Adding spurious information also constitutes loss of information. So the lossless join is to be interpreted in that term. In general, when we use the ER model and derive our table definitions from that model, we would often get our tables in the third normal form. But we must cross-check. Each table that you design should be examined in this form. In general, when you do a system analysis, you will be representing stores, you will be representing entities, and you will be making a data dictionary which will contain all your metadata. You will agree that that metadata will contain all attributes that you have. Ideally, before proceeding further during the type of analysis, you should identify functional dependencies. Functional dependencies across the whole corporation. And you should clearly have a list of each attribute which not only says what that attribute is, etc., but what it is functionally dependent on. Is it dependent on one attribute, two, four, five, etc.? Clearly, you must focus on functional dependency on key attributes. If you have followed an entity model, then you would have identified primary key, candidate keys, etc. It is important to try and identify such functional dependencies at that point itself. And you can do that very easily by, even if you do not know the domain, by looking at the typical values which are stored against those entities. Okay, you can generally figure out, you can ask questions, you can think, and you can apply your mind. We will now construct an example of transitive dependency and we'll show why third normal form is essential. That we'll do is as an exercise here. As I mentioned, there's a Boyce Codd normal form or BCNF which insists on dependence on, or it is defined in terms of dependence on candidate keys. There are many more interesting aspects of the normalization theory. If you read the corresponding chapter from the Sudarshan's book, you will also find algorithms to determine the normal forms. For example, there is a Klein closure algorithm. Basically, if you have a list of functional dependencies, there are tools to which you feed these functional dependencies and it will give you alternatives for third normal form design. So if you are starting afresh, that could be one way of doing things. It is not ordinarily done because functional dependency, sadly, has not been a concept which is rigorously used during the analysis phase, and therefore that option is not available during design. But if you want to re-engineer a COBOL system, for example, and convert it into a complete database system, you have to ensure that all the variables in your COBOL programs which represent fields of your files, those are the stores, then the functional dependencies of those fields, not only on the primary keys of the file that you currently have, but on any other primary keys or components of primary keys which are elsewhere, or composite primary. That exercise is a fairly large exercise. Unless you do that, you will not be able to guarantee that your final stores are in third normal form. So this is some exercise that should be undertaken. Now let's look at the This is the reference of a book, by the way, Software Engineering, A Practitioner's Approach. Remember, I mentioned the book by Roger Pressman. This is the website, so you can possibly access the slides or something. Just like most of us treat Sudarshan's book as the Bible on databases, most software engineering teachers, students and professors treat this as the Bible of software engineering. So it would be a very, very useful book to have, which describes complete end-to-end the entire software engineering process, including, of course, the design and so on. So we'll now go back to constructing an example here. Let's say I am designing a table for a material management system of an organization where I have various parts or sub-assemblies, I have codes for them. These parts are supplied by suppliers who stay at various places. Then there are quantity at hand available, etc., etc., etc. I have originally started with a table which has part code, supplier code, user factory code, whatever, whatever, everything. And I figured out that jumble is not in second normal form. So I have removed everything. And I have reduced one of my tables of coming out of such projections, which has supplier code as the primary key. And this supplier code supplies certain item. Okay. And this, there is a city there. And there is a rebate available for that particular city, depending upon the distance of that city from my operational location. So, for example, if somebody is in, let's say, Delhi, I might say the rebate given to Delhi, because Delhi is a very far off place, and unless he offers me a rebate, I will not be able to purchase it because there will be a heavy transport cost. So this rebate may be as much as 25%. Let's say there is somebody in Pune and the rebate may be only 5%. So this is supplier X, this is supplier Y, this is supplier Z. Z is also from Pune. He supplies some other part. For the moment, we assume that each supplier supplies only one part. So he supplies item 1, I1, he supplies I2, he supplies I3. And of course, this Mr. Supplier, Mr. Z, will also give me a 5% rebate. These rebates I have standardized depending upon the distance of my place to those cities. So let's say I'm in Mumbai or some place, so I expect these rebates. Anybody who gives me these rebates, I will do business, otherwise I'll not do business. If supplier code is the primary key, what are the functional dependencies?
Item.
Supplier code functionally determines item. Is that okay? In fact, that's the primary key. So it also determines city. It also determines rebate. There is no problem in that. Because wherever a particular supplier code comes, the rebate. In fact, the key for this could very well be supplier code plus item. Because multiple items may be supplied by the supplier. So there could be supplier code plus item, let's say. In which case, I will rewrite this to mean SUP code plus item code defines rebate, and SUP code plus item code defines city. Is that okay? So if this is my primary key, then city and rebate both are fully functionally dependent on this. There is no problem. This is in second normal form. What I meant by transitional dependency is that rebate is also functionally dependent on city. Is that correct? Because I have decided this rebate figure based on the city, the distance of the city. Now, look at the same problem that you have. First of all, redundancy, which is not so much relevant here. But what is important is, suppose for some reason, this X goes out of business. Then the rebate for Delhi, that information is lost. Some material manager, when he identifies a new vendor in Delhi to supply something, will have to figure out what should be the rebate for Delhi. Now, he might suddenly say only 4% chalega. Or he might say 10% chahiye. Whereas the standard practice of the organization was this. So notice that because of this transitive dependency, I have a similar problem of not being able to represent properly all the information relevant. This is happening because rebate is fully functionally dependent on supply code plus item and is also fully functionally dependent on city, which in turn is dependent on supply code plus item. Since this dependency is like that, that is the dependency which we refer to as the transitive dependence. Oh, sorry, you can't see this. Okay. You note the word. So this rebate, I will say, so rebate is transitively fully functional dependent on supply code plus item. And I don't like this transitive dependency because it is creating this problem. So what is the answer? Simple, project it out. But you can't project out city and rebate out of this. You have to retain something here. So in the transitive dependency part, you first identify what is the individual dependency of the components that you are concerned with in the transitive dependency. City and rebate, therefore, must form a separate table. You agree that whenever I put the city and rebate like this, then it will solve the transitive, it will solve the problem of losing out information. Delhi will always remain here with 25, Pune will remain here with 5. In fact, I can go to Madras, Jharsuguda, Guwahati, all the cities I can define all the rebates here. But whenever a particular supplier comes, the supplier item information would be related only to city. So there are two projections that I do. One is I take the supplier code item and that particular component on which somebody else is transitively dependent, or through which somebody else is transitively dependent. I take that and project it here. And I take this particular element and the attribute which transitively depends on this into a separate table. You agree that these two tables will solve the problem exactly the same way as the second normalization solved the earlier problem. This then is the importance of transitive dependencies. Please note that these examples look very simple because there are very few attributes here. You may generally have to contend with a total of something like 2,500 attributes, maybe more. And you never know which attribute is related to which, in which way. So this is not a trivial exercise at all, identifying functional dependence. But you can also notice that it is an important exercise. Without that, you will not be able to guarantee that your design is good. So there are tools. I do not know whether LIC has access to those tools. Does Rational have anything to do with normalization or functional dependencies? We don't know. You may cross-check that. There were tools specifically for re-engineering which had this attribute, that they could actually get as input the functional dependencies and prepare a what you call different sets, which are like your table designs, you know, that you take these attributes and this, etc., etc., and work that out. Anyway, we'll stop here. As I said,